Hello, everyone. Welcome to episode 6 of Talk of Fame podcast. I'm Kylie and Suksa Haban, an actor who has played in roles such as Sex and the City, Brothers and Sisters, Switch at Birth, and Nebelius Maze. And he also danced on season 8 of Dancing with the Stars and returned to the show on season 15. And he was also a French co-host of the Netflix show Intimidate Breastmaster, Gilles Martini. Thank you so much for coming on.
Nice to meet you. How are you, Kelly?
I'm good. How are you?
Very good. Very good. Very happy to be here.
Thank you. I'm very happy you're here. The first question is, how did you know you wanted to be an actor?
Wow. You know what? I always thought I'd stumble on it through looking for this career, no matter what. So I realized, because my mother, not long ago, about 10 years ago, sent me a video of me pretending to be a comedian in the middle of the forest, actually, with my father and my mom and my brother and my sister. And I realized I was literally performing in front of them, different comedian, a skit. And I was really into it. And I felt when I watched that video, and I was 15 years old when that video was made, I'm like, I always wanted to do that. I just didn't want to. More than admit it, I didn't want to really believe it, because you know how difficult it is to get into this business and let alone making something happen in this business. It's very complicated. And it's, you know, they call it one in a million. So I kept it very quiet. I worked through the ropes. I opened the small little doors left and right, and I became a career in acting. But I believe I was meant to do this since I can remember. I just like blocked it because it was such a far distant dream. And this is where we were talking about. As long as it kept to be a dream, I let it float away because it's just a dream. As soon as I realized this is a career, this is a goal of mine. And then pieces by pieces, everything became, oh, it's possible. It's not impossible. So that's why I like to call them goals.
Yeah, that's awesome. Since, like, as long as you remember, you wanted to do acting. And at first, like, a while ago, I wanted to do acting. It was right off base because I watched, like, a lot of movies, a lot of television growing up. So I was like, wow, then this is a really good business to be into. But then as I got older, I was thinking myself, like, oh, I'm not sure this anymore. But, like, asking myself, like, I love acting, like, I can just do it anytime, like, try to do it for fun. It's great to see, like, you and so many other actors to be such a part of an amazing, like, business and be such amazing films. And, like, it's just truly amazing that you get to be part of such, like, a big, good business.
Oh, it's an absolute blessing. When things works, it's more than a blessing. Sometimes you feel like this is a lot. They're giving a lot for just pretending all day long. I always say that if you feel like you cannot live without feeling that you need and must act and be an actor and create and make people feel, and if you feel you cannot live without it, then that's what you're going to do. If you just want to do it because you want to try it or see if you like it, that's a different story. It takes a lot of a desire, and that aura that you're gonna bring out there will make things happen. It's really like it has to be a pure passion, or it's very difficult.
Yeah, like for some actors, it's like very difficult for depending like on the role, like for the movie or show or whatever it is, like it depends on the role, how hard it is or not to get into, but you just like type of character you're trying to get into. And like for some characters, like the things I've seen you in, like you did, like I can really connect with your characters, and I was like, wow, it's such a great job. Like
is a simple little trick of truly believing what you are doing at the moment of the scene. You hear the DP or the directors is rolling in action, and you feel all these things coming alive inside of you that is not really you. it's you being part of that scene and that I'm in love, my wife is leaving to the beach, lucky them. And so I think this is where it's beautiful, and I believe it has to come completely naturally. If you need to make people feel, you need to believe what you're doing.
Yeah. What was it like for you to appear on Dancing with the Stars?
Wow, it was insane. I have never danced before. I have never performed in front of a massive audience like that before. So it was a bit of a shock, and kind of like you're on top of a rock and you have to jump in the ocean and it's full of big sharks and you got to go for it. They won't bite you, but you got to go for it. You're like, oh no. So it's very scary. I'm kind of a perfectionist when it comes down to performing. I know when there's no safety net, you know, when you don't have to say, oh my God, I messed up. Let's cut, right? Usually you don't say that as an actor, director will do it. But, and you redo it because there's no more film. It's all digital. It's okay. When you perform on Dancing with the Stars, you're live. They call your name. And if you fall on your face, well, you fall on your face. So to me, what I try to come across with the show is like a person like you and I that have never performed in front of an audience, that has never danced before, that his job is acting. So he's called Dancing with the Stars. So it's taking someone like this and showing America that it's possible to do anything if you really put your mind to it. And my goal was to express myself as much as possible. I am not a dancer. I don't know what the step or the counting or any of that is about. So for me, the entire experience was musical. I believe I have rhythm. Otherwise, if I had two left feet, it would have been a problem. And I believe I did well because I rehearsed until I couldn't move every night. I was a bit of a extreme... training session for me. Like literally I could have done even twice more. I wanted to, when they call my name and they call my partner's name and we're doing the dance, I didn't want to see any differences between the professional and the novice.
Yeah, like I'm just like the same exact way because I'll be like nervous performing in front of like millions of people that are there and are watching on television because I used to watch Dancing with the Stars a lot and I used to be obsessed with it. And
yeah.
I have my sister used to dance, my oldest sister Kara, and like she used to dance with me and sing with me as a kid. And she used to like dance with me. Like I wasn't really a dancer. Like I didn't like to really dance as a kid, but as I got older, I started dancing more often. I got more into dancing in that I usually dance every day, usually.
It's very important. It's the joy in your soul. As soon as you dance and you feel and you create movement, movements become stories. I absolutely adore dancing.
Yeah, like dancing is like my best passion. I did like every step and every day. I can literally like dance like any song ever. And
that's cool.
Sometimes I'll be in my parents' room and the door will be shut and I'll be like on TikTok doing dances or just dancing. They'll walk on me. I'll be like, cool, you scared me. AirPods in, so like they won't hear me. I'll be like doing my own thing and they'll be clutching me.
That's
very awkward for me because I like to do that like by myself because I kind of don't like people seeing me kind of dance. So like, it's like I do let people.
You should not care. You should actually share because every time you will dance and someone catches you dancing, you fill their heart with so much happiness. Trust me. And if anybody tells you otherwise, it's because they just cannot do what you just did. Just really, really enjoy dancing. And don't worry about, do it like, you know, like the expression, like no one is watching. Have fun. Because it really helps a lot of people with their sadness in life. You know, you see someone dance. It could be like, it happens sometime in Los Angeles. Like you go to a stop sign and, we're light, and there's this homeless not far away from here that is always somehow dancing. You just love the guy. Why? Because he's dancing. I don't know him. Every time I see him, he's dancing and he's happy and he's twirling around and you're like, I don't care what's happening here. You're making everyone around you happy. And that's what you do. So don't be shy about dancing in front of your parents or your brothers and sisters. And actually, it's a great way to exteriorize who you are. It becomes more normal and natural to perform. So go for it. I really recommend it. And sing. I don't know if you sing. I don't care if you sing really well or not. Sing, dance, make people feel. It's important.
Yeah, I sing and dance so much. It depends on the song. I love like a lot of songs and music and bands, singers and everything. And like, I'm really into anything like rap, pop, and like basically anything. And sometimes I'll be like singing, like, let's just say like Love is a Battlefield by Luke Evans, because I'm a massive Luke Evans fan, or the Greatest Showman songs. I'll sing any of those songs.
That's hard to sing.
Yeah, like I'll sing some parts. I won't sing the whole thing, but like I'll sing half of it and I'll be like singing for
awesome.
Thing. Now and I'd be outside the gym and I was like, while I'm exercising outside, I do my own thing and my parents will be laughing at me like I would make smiles on my face. Like
trust me, you feel their heart with a lot of happiness. I know I have kids. If I see my kid dancing outside, I would be so happy.
Yeah, like it's like my biggest joy. Sometimes I just do it to be funny. I'll be like, do like a move to make someone laugh.
Beautiful.
It's like, which is funny. It amazes my parents, the whole family. Sometimes I just do it out of nowhere to be pretty hysterical with my parents and just try to do something. Or just
it's good.
My brother often, that is trying to do often. He's my brother walked in on me like a couple days ago dancing. I was like, he's just stood there. He's like, what you doing there? I'm like, nothing.
That's cool.
Yeah, I was like, oh no. I was like to Jennifer Lopez. I was like, oh no.
Oh yeah. Well, that would be a lot of dancing on Jennifer Lopez, that's for sure.
Yeah, because I'm a massive Jennifer Lopez fan. I'm like listening to all her songs and stuff. It's like her songs have like good beats to it, like on the floor, yeah. Any of the songs, like they have like good.
It's like mainstream pop is what it's meant and to make people like lightly make them go away from there every moment and feel it. You know, that's really beautiful and important. I'm sure it's really important for a lot of people.
Yeah. What is some advice for people who would like to be like you one day?
That's a very good question because of course my answer changes every year more than ever during these times. Just try to really try to listen more than being convinced that you know. Take advice and criticism as a template to build your little mind empire and where you want to go, because it's always very important, I think, to have a lot of like from your family to your friends, the people who will be jealous of you, the people who will be with you, supporting you, not supporting you. You need all of them to create it and complete the puzzle that you need to complete to really do this career. It's very important to listen, to learn, and if you have a template, someone that you really admire, kind of look at the background of their life with a grain of salt because everybody's different also, but try to emulate what they did right to be where they are. If it comes down to my life, I literally came here. I didn't speak a word of English. Not that I speak better, but maybe a little bit. I didn't speak a word of English. I came with just less than $500. I have an entire plan in my mind, but I knew it would take an enormous amount of time. It took 12 years, I believe, 10 years, 12 years for me to, no, 10 years. It took 10 years for me to really do something. I needed to learn the language. I had a child to take care of it at the same time, a wife and everything else. So it was a bit complex, but I listened, I paid attention. And when I had the opportunity to do something, That's very crucial. You get an opportunity, you don't take it lightly. I don't care if the opportunity is for you to play tomorrow in the first team of the volleyball team. Take that opportunity as you have the opportunity to become the president of the United States. Same way, treat it the same way. Go full on, dedicate yourself, and say, this is what I want to do. Why this person is better than that? Oh, because they're doing this. Or let's try that and do more. And always look up. I made a big mistake around your age, a little younger, to tell my father, Dad, don't be mad at me with schoolwork. There's a lot of people that are worse than me. In France, bam, I got it. He said, never look down. Always look at the people who do much better things and see what you need to do to get to that point without crossing anyone or hurting anyone. And this is why it took me much, much longer. I never was a person who envy anyone, who want to be someone. I was looking at how good they have it and what they did for having it good like that, not to try to take anything away from them. I create my own self. So just like on Dancing with the Stars, a lot of people say, I want to do what Jill did. No, just look at what I did to do that. Don't try to emulate. Just try to understand the concept of the work and what they did, and then do it with your own ways, but do it.
Yeah, I totally agree on that. Like, sometimes I'll think, like, let's say, like, I'm outside with friends or something, and they try to do something. I'm thinking myself, or just watching something on television, I see something, like, pretty cool that the person did. I'll be like, wow, I want to do what they did, or I want to be like them. And I'm thinking myself, like, you can try that, too, but you can, I don't know if you'll be good as the person that actually did it. Like, can at least try and see, like, if you can do it. Like, if you want to do this, like, then you should do it, no matter how people think of it.
And, absolutely.
And for the podcast, even if people don't support it, and if people like it, if people don't like it, which is fine, it's their own opinion. I won't, like, change their opinion by something. This is not, it's their opinion. Everyone has opinions, including myself. So, like,
more than ever.
Yeah, and so, like, I'd be like, if they don't like it, they don't like it. They can do something else. Like, they'll find other podcasts to listen.
Absolutely. Like, no, congratulations on this. This is really amazing to do that at your age and doing it. So, kudos to you.
Thank you. Like, this, like, and, like, people my age, like, it's kind of, like, hard. These, like, some people don't do these type of things when they're kind of, like, young. And so, like, people usually do their own thing and stuff, and I try to do as much as I can because I see, like, a lot of people doing this. I have this person that's older than me, a couple years older, and that does podcasts. I was like, she's in, like, senior in high school, I believe, and I was like, wow, she's really good at this. I should try. And then I'm like, I don't know. Like, I was thinking about it. I was like, tell my parents, like, do you think this is a good idea? And they're like, yeah, it's a good idea. And I started doing it. And I have, I come along with two people in my family that do journalism, kind of this, for my local news station. My aunt, her husband, my aunt Rennie, and my cousin John, they both do, like, journalism for my local news station, a couple minutes away from my house. And I'm really close with both of them. I'm really close with them. So, like, like, they really inspired me to do this since, like, I grew up, like, I knew them my whole life, and they usually do these type of things. So I was like, wow, this, they're really the reason why I started this. And I even started podcasts, I even thought, like, wow, like, I thought their thing was pretty cool. I was talking to my aunt about it, and she was like, yeah, you should do this, because I kind of thought it was really interesting. I guess they did, and I was, like, talking to them about it. I was like, what was it like for you guys? And they're like, pretty awesome. Like, it kind of changed with everything going on with COVID, but, like, it's, like, pretty cool to see, like, have, like, a mentor and, like, kind of like a mentor, like, look up to you and guide you where you want to go.
Yeah, really good job, sweetie. Really, really good job. And have the support of your family is going to be everything, because no strings attached, you go for it. You have support behind you. So this is great.
Thank you. Out of all the roles you did, what role has meant the most to you?
I have to say, I have to say when I was on Brothers and Sisters, and the reason is I do this movie, a small little part in this movie that made a lot of money. So then, you know, Hollywood pays attention to that, of course, the numbers. And from that, I got offered to do Dancing with the Stars. So you saw it. It just catapulted me to a different place. And I'm always going to be very thankful to Brothers and Sisters. But working as an actor is always what I wanted to do, not doing a dancing show on a reality platform. So because it was an art form, I really allowed myself to do that twice. But when I got to Brothers and Sisters, I was sitting, Kylie, it's very powerful to me because I was sitting around the table with every single actor around me and director, nominated or won Golden Globes, SAG Award, Oscars. I'm talking about everything under the spectrum. They won it all. I was sitting with legend of acting around me, and some coming up like Matthew Reese, Dave Annabelle. Those guys were coming up, and they were just incredible actors. So for me, it was an acting boot camp, but at the same time, I knew I was sitting around this table. I'm like, Jean, suck this in, because it probably would never happen again to have this magnitude of actors sitting next to each other. Ken Olin is an incredible creator, director. He's a fabulous human being and a great actor. So working with people like that completely changed my life and my perspective of the possibilities that you can have when you come from nothing.
Yeah, I totally agree. It's like, if I had the opportunity, I'd be like, wow, this is like crazy. So with Oscar winners and Academy Award winners or whoever they won SAG Awards, now would be like kind of like a nervous wreck, be like, oh wow, I'm sitting next to legends, and the guy would be like, wow, this is crazy. This is
possible. Yeah, it was a beautiful time in my life. I had to pinch myself every other day, you know.
Yeah, it's like such a once in a lifetime opportunity. I would, like, if I was me, I'd be like, wow, this is truly amazing. This is probably once in a lifetime opportunity they get sit around with like one of the best actors of all time. So it's amazing that you really got the experiences.
I mean, Rachel Griffiths, Sally Field, Calista Flockhart, Rob Lowe, everyone was there. I know it's not your generation. I'm probably throwing names that your parents know really well, but it was humbling every second of the day.
Yeah, that's truly awesome. He's like I would like to spend a day with everyone. Like, it's really cool to sit with like actors that you might look up to in your life, or you want to be like them, or you want to, whatever it is, or inspired you in many ways. It's just pretty cool to like sit around these like talented people, which is my dream, to like be around these amazing people and have like a great fan base like you do and everyone else does. So, like, I'm just hoping be like a,
remember, Kylie, aim high. Aim really high. It's the simple thing of reach for the stars. The worst that can happen when you fall back down, you can grab the moon. The moon is pretty good to grab versus everybody else. So aim really high.
Thank you. I totally love that. Because that's like, a lot of people always tell me reach for the stars or like, try to do things that you're really passionate about. And I always get like, inspired, like a lot of people tell me, like reach for stars. Like I said before, like these people have their own things. Like as I was growing up, like I didn't do too many things as a kid because I grew up with severe anxiety, so that didn't lead me to do these type of things as a kid and stuff. And I was always like jealous of my brother, and because of his all his compliments of baseball and sports, I was like, oh, how am I want to get like a good treatment from this. Like I want to try to figure out something. Like I didn't know like what my thing was at the time. So once I found out the podcast, I was like, I think this is my time to shine.
Of course. By the way, don't be jealous of your brother. It's mainly, I'm sure, mainly the sports, the movement. It's the world. This world is still too geared toward having the possibility as a young boy to have a lot more fun. I have to admit that, because I can see how much fun and things I did with my son that now is 22 years old, and the thing that I did with my daughter. We have this thought, specifically probably fathers, that, oh, it's my daughter. I'm going to cherish her. I'm going to make her, you know, feel good and all beautiful and preppy and whatnot, where she's just another human being that wants to kick butt and have a great time. So it's very difficult sometimes to even like when you were coming down to talking about sports. If you love American football, it's going to be tough for a woman to play, or baseball. I mean, there's softball, but this is where it needs to be. First of all, last time I checked, it looks like there's now more women born than men. So it's time for you to take over this world. We desperately need it to have women in power so we can calm down and move forward and love Mother Nature. That is also what they do as being. It's time for women to take over the world, because we did not do a good job so far. Men, we just did not. So I'm expecting a big change very soon when it comes down to that landscape and beautiful things coming up to this world. And I hope your generation is going to fix us, because we really did not do a good job.
Yeah, I totally agree with you on that. Like, I think it's like girls and young girls or women to kind of shine, because I'm really big into that stuff. Like girl, woman represented as same as men. And I'm really like my Gina Davis, as I said before, I was a big fan, massive fan of her as well. And like the work she does, her institute, trying to make women equal with men and stuff like that. I was like, that's how it really got me started with these thinking is from her. And I was like, wow. I was like, tell my mom, like my parents, like, wow, this, how,
it's, I was born. It's funny, like, it's funny your name. It's funny you say Gina Davis. It is definitely more my generation than yours, and that you are telling me that you are a massive fan of Gina Davis. If are we talking about the American actress, right?
Yeah,
that's amazing. I really admire her. That's no doubt about it. She's a great. She's an advocate. She's really, really a great person for sure.
Yeah, I've been a fan of her for at least 2 years now. Like, I also became a fan of her last year because my mom showed me like a film of hers. It was a League of Their Own. Like, she showed me that.
Which film you saw?
League of Their Own.
Okay, got it.
And my mom showed me that movie once quarantine started. I never seen that movie ever. And I was like, wow. Then I became obsessed with her after that movie. And once I learned like what she was doing with her institute and like what trying to get women represented with men, and I was like, wow, that's how it really got me started, like trying to fix things is from her. And I admire her so much, and she's really my hero. She's really the reason why I'm doing this podcast.
That's awesome. You got to get on the show.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm trying so hard to get her on. Like, it would be my dream come true to have her on. And she's such an inspiration, not only for me, but every woman in the world that has heard of her. And it's like, yeah, a lot of people, like Emma Watson and so many other
people. Oh, yeah, Emma is an absolute incredible actor. I can't wait to watch Cruella. I can't wait.
Oh,
beautiful. Looks so good. Keep talking. I'm just gonna, you know what I'm gonna do that I forgot, Kylie? I'm cooking, and sometime, because everybody went to the beach, I better shut the cooking, otherwise it's gonna burn. So I'm doing a live shut off before everything burns out. As you can hear, yeah, it was time. And shut there and shut there. There we go.
Sorry. You're all right. You played Dante on a show, Sex in the City. What was the part of a popular show?
Well, it was actually the movie that came out from the show. Same thing, same concept, same actors. And what was interesting, because I'm very much. The one thing that was involved in the film that were a little bit out there, I would say, not a film for people your age still. because it's very much rated R. And I was playing someone that was the mirror image of one of the main character of the film, named Samantha. And she was very libertine and a little bit out there. So I have to replicate what she was during the 5 years run of the show, 8 years run of the show. It was very interesting to do. Also, I had no idea what this movie was going to do to me. And the director of the movie, Michael Patrick King, is an absolute legend, a gold human being. You know, he's a very beautiful human being. And he told me, "You're going to hate me." I'm like, that's during the first day of shooting, after we did a couple scenes. And he's like, "Oh, why are you saying that?" So you're going to hate me because the moment this movie comes out, your phone will never stop ringing. And it happened. So I think he had a lot of smarts and common sense. And he realized that what we were doing was going to be something very specific that a lot of women and men and everybody else will react to it. So it became kind of the cameo in the movie that everybody talked about. So it put me in a platform where I never saw myself going as fast as that. 2008 in May, my life completely changed from 0-60 in an hour and a half or 2 hours. I sat down. I don't know if you know who Fergie is. She's a singer.
I think I remember.
And very popular singer, beautiful, beautiful, beautiful person. And she sat next to me because I came along with a friend of mine. I've flown to New York. For me, it was like incredible. And I'm watching this film and she's sitting next to me. Is like, "Oh, I know who you are." And I was like, "I know who she is, but she should not know who I am." She's like, "You know, I did the music for the movie. And get ready. Your scenes are incredible. And a lot of people want to talk about it." And I was just freaking out. And I saw why. And next thing you know, the movie stopped. I promise you. I don't say that often. When the movie stopped at this Radio City Hall in New York City, there's like 4,000 people there. It's like massive, like 4,000. It was as much people outside wanted to go inside to watch this film, that inside. It was insane. It was a sea of people. The moment the movie stopped, everybody stopped looking for the lead actress. And I didn't realize everybody was looking for, where is this guy? It took me hours to get it out of the theater. I have never experienced that. People grabbing you, want to have a piece of you. And that was my first feel of what stardom is about. It's insane because at one moment, you're a normal human being. You give five to a guy next to you. Next thing you know, you stand up and there's the world watching and want you. And that you need to be ready. Because if you're not, your head explodes. It's so easy to pretend something you're not. So I'm very happy that I already had the kid. And I actually had both of my kids at that time. And a wife, now it's been 23 years. So that gave me the balance to make it happen. And Sex and the City gave me that platform and that trampoline, I will say.
Yeah, I mean, it's like the Sex and the City, like the movie and the show is very popular because a lot of people talk about it. Like, I've never seen the movie because I'm like, too young to see it. But I hear a lot of people talk about it. I see on TV every once in a while when I'm scrolling through and everyone talks about it. I'm like, wow, this is the thing.
I think the show, the movie are something like a big bang, right? A congratulations of having an amazing show. But I believe the TV show was revolutionary. It was really interesting to see women perspective on TV and period. It's a great educational TV show for men. So we can maybe understand women a little bit more. And that is why I absolutely loved the show more than anything else. Yeah.
Yeah,
like, even if I wasn't part of it.
Yeah, like the movie and the show, like, so resonates. How many years it's been out now? Like, resonates still today of 2021, and like it's crazy to be like an A-lister, because like, or how many like where how much famous you are, basically. It's like crazy. These fans, paparazzi, are always like following you everywhere. That's what I'm scared, like, to be around is, like, paparazzi. Like, when I went to L.A., like, I think it was, like, 2 years ago with my dad. We were gone somewhere. We were going there for a Dodger game, actually, one day. And it was our last day at our last day there until we were going home next morning. And I was, like, I saw, like, when we were at the Grove or something. It was at this nice place. It has, like, a lot of stores. I think it was the Grove, I think. It was
The Grove is very popular for that, yeah.
Yeah, I think it was the Grove. And I heard, like, a lot of people go there. So I was, like, maybe I'll see someone. But I didn't end up seeing anyone that day. And I saw a paparazzi, like, walking around. I was, like, me and my dad caught it. Well, my dad caught it, but he told me. I was, like, wow, like, this is how crazy the paparazzi is, like, this.
Yeah, but I gotta tell you maybe a different perspective when it comes down to paparazzi. It's very easy for actors, A-listers, like, super famous people to be like, oh, leave me alone. But paparazzi have created hundreds and hundreds of careers. We have to give them some kind of respect, as much as it could be invasive and whatnot. When they take a picture of you, you end up in magazines. And there's no such things of bad publicity the last 20 years in America. If you're in the magazine, you're relevant. If you're relevant, you make money. So I believe actors should just calm the hell down. I'm going to be polite. And not really pointing finger at paparazzi, because there is an extreme, like the Britney Spears stories, where it's too much. It's insane. Leave her alone. But paparazzi are never invasive like that. You know, I've been around people that are extremely famous, and I have never seen someone being very disrespectful or mean or doing something they're not supposed to, because there's a lot of regulations and stuff now. I'm never going to point the finger of paparazzi. To me, they just serve me incredibly well. They took a lot of pictures without my knowledge. I can be in a restaurant with my kids, or I can be anywhere. They don't affect you. You know, if you do something wrong, you're going to get caught. And when you become someone in the limelight, you have a responsibility, just like politicians. You cannot say whatever you feel. You got to be smart with it, right? So, no, I ain't going to blame or point at paparazzi. I believe they made more career than destroying them. That's for sure.
Yeah, I totally agree, because I kind of feel like I respect, like, the people there, and I kind of find this somewhat cool, because they can at least, like, talk to the celebrities, and some people, like, some celebrities find it, like, they don't like it, which is perfectly fine, you know, like, the paparazzi.
Fine. Yeah, but I don't care if they don't like it, because they are public persons. So now, if they don't like it, they stop what they're doing, and they lose all their amazing things that they got through acting. You know, you have to... You know, they always say there's a price to pay. If the price to pay is people going around you and try to take picture of you and whatever it is, this is not a price to pay. Come on. It is all fine. The price to pay is if you live in the studio with three kids and you make $1,000 a month and you can barely make ends meet and put food on the table. That's a hard price to pay. But having people following you because you're famous, it's not a big deal. Trust me. There's no abuse like they portrayed it back in the days. It's not like that. I actually know a guy that used to be a paparazzi, and he's one of the most respectful guy I ever met in my life. So I have no problem with them, for sure.
Yeah, like, I wouldn't find, like, them offensive, even if I was famous. Like, I wouldn't mind, like, them, like, taking pictures of me, even if I was, like, my cousins, my little cousins, or my family. I wouldn't care. I'd be like, oh, cool, take pictures. I'd be fine with that. I'd be like, peace out. Like,
what happened. That happened a lot. When the world was normal, I would go to the Grove and places like that with friends of mine or family, and then sometimes they don't know who they are, so they create names. So if Kylie, you were with me at the Grove, the paparazzi will take pictures and they will say, oh, that's his daughter. And sometimes that happens and you're like, oh no, that's Kylie, but it's okay. And it happens a lot, and you end up on People magazine out of nowhere. To go to the newsstand, you're like, oh my God, I'm here. So most of my friends and family that ended up in magazines and such always loved it. Nobody says, I don't want to be in the photo in the magazine. No, that never happened.
Yeah, like, I find that, like, pretty funny, because, like, I've seen like a lot of people, like, say, confuse people for, are they, like, dating, or is that their daughter or whoever it may be. I'll be like, wow, that's pretty funny. Like, that they find out that Like, I get confused with people all the time. Like, I'd be like sometimes, like, I look at, like, a lot of my aunt. Like, I mentioned my aunt before, my aunt Rennie. Some people confuse me as her daughter, and I'm like, "Are you her daughter?" And I'm like, "Oh no, I'm not. I'm yes,
We
like
probably look alike, so that's why.
you're kind of close." But that's how like me and my aunt look alike. Because I get told like, "Oh, you look alike." Like me and my aunt, me and my sister look a lot alike too. So I like people would say, "Oh, she's a young Rennie or she's a young Kara." Because
Yeah.
those like two all the time. Like I get it like every single day. Like, "Oh, you look like these two people." I'm like, "Daughter, all right? I'm not her daughter."
That's funny, but that's normal. Family, we look alike. Thank God. That means we are family.
Like it's good to get like people saying genes, like getting to like get to look like people in your family, which is means like you're actually like family, you know how close we are and everything. So I'm really close with my family. I love my family more than anything. So like it's really cool to get some people that you actually like look up to more than you can explain. And I look up to my aunt so much and everyone.
That's awesome. Next time somebody say, "Oh my God, is that your daughter?" She's like, "Kind of, but close."
Kind of. Yeah, she's my godmom. So like I'll be like sometimes I'll be joking around saying, "Me, yeah." I'll be sometimes be like, "Yeah." She's like, "I
That's funny. I would do that too.
Yeah, so I'll be laughing. I'll be like, tell my parents, I'll be like, "Mom, my friends are saying, is that your mom?" I'm like, no, she's
Funny. That's cool. That's
kind of. Just
cool.
kind of now, like, start laughing, start like, I find it like, pretty funny. And well, at least people think she's my mom because, like, I guess family genes are running for me, I guess.
That's great. That means, is that your mom's sister?
It's my dad's cousin, but I call her my aunt because she's my
Same. It's just
yeah,
yeah,
mom's side is called my aunt and stuff. Like she's my dad's mom's sister's daughter.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah. Oh yeah, it's direct bloodlines, yeah.
Yeah, so I call her my aunt because she's my godmother, and I always called her that since I was born. So like I was always continued to call her like my aunt's like
Yeah,
it's
your
just
grandmother,
bothered me to
but it's
call her
very
aunt. I just like felt comfortable like calling her
that's awesome.
name. The final question is, you co-host a Netflix show, Ultimate Beastmaster.
Ultimate Beastmaster, yeah.
What was it like for you to co-host a show?
Very new for me. I knew I was game to do it because the show surrounded sports, extreme sports. That's all I love. So I was very in tune with the athletes. Actually, one of the athletes on the show came to my house last week.
Really?
So I kept contact with her. And believe it or not, when she did the show, I believe 2017, 2018, Vanessa was a lot of ups and down in her life and whatnot, but she was very good at jujitsu. So we rolled around, we shared techniques and stuff, and she ended up having a lot of world title in jujitsu. And then she ended up doing mixed martial arts. And she ended up world champion. Like right now, she's one of the top athletes in the world. And
Wow.
when I met her, just like you, it was just a goal or a dream. And now she accomplished it. And she's not even done yet. She's not even done. She wants to be a champion in different organizations, and her desire is incredible. And I'm very proud of her. But you see, that's also a valuable thing to do when you work on the show, or when you work on at a job somewhere, and you create a relationship. It's good to entertain that relationship for forever, possibly become very good friends. It's the beauty of having the abilities of. I would have never met that woman if I was not for this show. And this show took the best athlete on planet Earth and put them together. And that was a great opportunity for me to host this. It was very much fast. You gotta be on your game. And did you know that the set of Ultimate Beastmaster, you can see it from space?
Wait, really?
Yeah, that's what I heard from one of the producers. It's like, it's so massive and it's so in the middle of nowhere. There's no light anywhere. And this machine, when it lit up, I believe it was like a $5 million thing to build. And it's a massive, massive monster, like Godzilla type of monster. And it's a lot of jamboree and a lot of obstacle to go through, and you have to defeat the beast. That's why it's called the ultimate beast master. And guys from China, from Japan, from everywhere around the world, India, from France, of course, because I was hosting the French, but Spain and Italy. It was USA, of course. It was incredible to see the differences between the ability of the physicality between countries. It's real. It's really real. People are different shape and form and whatnot, and they're more into specific sports more than other countries. So I was very surprised by the resilience. Not very surprised because I knew a bit about it, but I was, you know, confirmed the reason the people from Mexico, the young athletes from Mexico were like, I'm dying with this. I don't care. They're really going at it. The smarts of the organization of all the Chinese team, they ended up winning. And specifically for the French community, we kind of created this parkour sports. That means, you know, those urban jumping around buildings and stuff. It's a sport, and it was, I believe, created in France. So we have a huge advance in France when it comes down to parkour. So jumping from one place to another. So the season that I did, the French team did amazingly well. We went all the way to the final, and it was really amazing to see a young French athlete being world champion in climbing and all that, coming here and me hosting them was just an honor for me to be around such athletes.
Yeah, that's really awesome. Like, when you get to like meet and chance to be part of like these one of the best athletes in the world. This is one of my like dreams to be big sports players, which I have. I met a couple, which is really awesome. I'm a massive Chase Utley fan. I don't know if you know who he is. He played for Chase Utley.
What is he doing?
He's a retired baseball player. He played for the Yankees and Dodgers.
I played for the Dodgers. Yeah, I heard the name. I heard the name. I'm not watching baseball all the time, but when, of course, the Dodgers are playing well, I'm watching. I love to watch the Red Sox against New York Yankees.
Oh yeah, that's a good series to watch. I love the Red Sox. Like, they're one of my favorites.
Yeah, I love watching those two teams going at it, and it's a great, great adversity, and that's, you know, sports to its perfect form, you know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, like Chase Utley is the reason why I love sports. He's my brother. My family is a massive Phillies fan, and my brother was named after Chase Utley, so my brother is Chase as well. And like before he retired, and back in like 2018, me and my family went to see the Phillies and Dodgers play, like when in Philly, and because my mom got tickets to go to the game, so I was like, oh, I'll go and go to the baseball game. We have something to do and stuff. And once I went to that game, he went up to bat. It went from like 18 innings, so it lasted until like 1 o'clock in the morning. We stayed the whole time. I was like exhausted, and like I got to see him bat, and I was like, wow, like this is insane. Then like after that game, I immediately became obsessed with him. Like immediately came loved him. Like I always been a fan of him since I was young, from being a fan of the Phillies growing up. But once I got to that game, it really changed my life and
awesome
sports, because he's really the reason why I love sports, is because of him. My whole family like knows, like, oh, she's a massive one. Oh, she, and my whole family knows, like, it's like crazy. And like my dad, once my parents knew, like, I was a Dodger fan, so I'm a Dodger fan and Phillies fan. And my family was so mad at me. He's like, yeah, you're not Phillies fan anymore. You're not part of his family. I'm like, what? When did I say I wasn't Phillies fan anymore?
Like, that's awesome.
I'm a Phillies fan, but like I'm just rooting for two teams at the same time. Like when the Dodgers, like I root for the Phillies at the same time, but when they're playing the Dodgers, I'm not. Like that's really the only.
That's I'm very much a soccer fan. I love soccer.
Yeah.
I played all my life, so I can relate. You know, it's my team is Marseille. No matter what, Marseille is the town that I will support until the day I die. And after that, there's a couple teams I like, but not like Marseille.
That's really great. Like, there's so many teams I like some players and stuff. Like, I like any sport, like football, baseball, soccer, whatever it is. I'll watch it for some time. I'll watch it every once in a while. But my two main are baseball and football. It's my family likes Penn State football. My family loves college football.
Mm-hmm. Like yeah, very popular in America for sure.
Yeah, and like
awesome.
Like my like, whole family is like sports fanatics. Like it's
good. Keeps the warm, the blood warm.
Yeah, like if I didn't become Phillies, if I became a Dodger fan, but I hated Phillies, I would be no longer part of the family. I'd be like, these are so true. So whole family was like mad. They're like, you traitor. I'm like, what did I say? The Phillies say, well, I'll support them. Like, the Dodgers are my team now. So, like, it doesn't matter. I like them, but when I'm playing the Dodgers, I'm done. And I'll be like, oh, you mean, when me and my brother will get into fights about it, and I'll be like, it's not my fault.
She's yeah, like, it's good. Sports is good. I love those.
Well, me too. Thank you so much for coming on.
My pleasure, Kylie. Thank you so much for having me. And I wish you all the absolute best. Keep going at it. Use this interview to get other people and aim high. Get Gina Davis. If I knew her, I would give her a call, of course. I just don't know her. And I wish I did. But, you know, use whatever you just did today to grow. And don't stop growing.
Well, thank you. It truly means a lot because I'm trying to grow as I go because I studied this a couple of weeks ago. So I'm trying to grow as I go, try to get smaller people on. That's what my family is like telling me to go slow, which I agree. I try to get like small people on, try to get as much as like I'm trying to get as much big people and small people on so I can know like what to
do. Yeah, get everybody. Everybody's interesting, sweetheart. Everyone is interesting. Actually, if I have anything to recommend you, maybe try to find some young writers in Hollywood or young athletes also. It's important. Just go out there and don't have any filter. Just say what you want and talk about their career and talk about yourself and talk about moving forward. We all need it. Okay?
Thank you so much.
It's my pleasure. Well, say hi to your entire family. Send them my love. And we keep in touch, okay?
Oh, definitely. Tell your family I said hello. Like, send all my love to, and we'll definitely keep in touch. And I'll make sure to tell my family. You're
beautiful.
Thank you so much.
All right. Thank you so much, Kylie. I'll talk to you very soon.